Welcome back to the Biblically Inspired Life. Today we're going to talk about midlife without a crisis. And the reason I say that is if you were to Google midlife on the internet, you would most certainly find crisis after that word. And why would you find that? It's very simple. When someone reaches middle age, they start thinking about the various goals and hopes and dreams that they had for their lives, and they have to recognize that some of these things are not going to be fulfilled. And this brings them great frustration, sadness, and a real sense of hopelessness sometimes, and they can behave in a very unseemly way trying to fight that in their lives. But what we need to realize is, as believers, there are some principles that we can glean from the scriptures which can help us through these times, through this stage of life, without having those feelings. Now, the first thing we need to realize is that joy is not obtained through external sources. And we need to think about what brings true joy. Well, we know the source of joy is the Lord. And the only way for us to have joy is in Him and through Him. Now, as I was reading some scripture and preparing for this, I noticed a couple of different kinds of situations which brought joy to the people. The first one was a more communal or congregational level. And this one I was thinking of in Nehemiah, where it says that the people had great joy when they heard the Torah and had it explained to them. So they felt great joy with an understanding of the Lord and His plan and more about the character of God. So one of the things that brings us great joy is serving the Lord together, understanding the Lord together in a communal situation. So it's very important for us to have a network of fellow believers that will support us, be friends with us, have true fellowship with us, and that satisfaction and that fulfillment will bring us great joy. And then another joy that we read about is more on a personal or individual level. And if you read through many of the writings of Paul, you will read that he had great joy at hearing about the faithfulness of the people. So hearing about testimonies of God's provision and blessing in others' lives and in your own life can be a real source of joy. I would really strongly suggest to each of you that you take a little bit of time and actually write down your testimony. This is something that is very helpful, not only for you personally, but as you go about your life and people maybe see you and say, you know, why are you different, or why are you so joyful? This will be a process that you can go through, which helps prepare you to share your testimony, to share what your faith means to you and what God is doing for you in your life. And of course, our joy is in our salvation, and we need to always recognize and understand that. 1 Peter 1:8, we rejoice with unspeakable joy and in the full glory of our salvation. So first of all, we need to recognize where our joy comes from. It's from our relationship and experience with the Lord through our salvation, and that is our source of joy, not any of the external sources. The second thing that we need to recognize is that life is made up of seasons. The famous chapter of the Bible, of course, is Ecclesiastes chapter 3, written by Solomon. In this book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon is near the end of his life. He has had many experiences, and he has lived a lot of it in an ungodly way. And what he's telling us is all of these things that he was seeking after that were outside the will of God were not satisfying to him. And so, first of all, we understand that ungodly pursuits are not going to bring us joy and satisfaction. And the other thing is, in chapter 3, he talks about there is a season for each thing. And sometimes, one of the things, I heard Baruch in his explanation and teaching on Ecclesiastes chapter 3, he was talking about a time to be born and a time to die. And that's not limited necessarily to our lives, but it could be a dream, an aspiration, a job. There's a time for maybe something to pass away. And we need to recognize that there are these different seasons in our lives, and that when one passes, another one comes with new opportunities and new joys facing us. So I'd like to really encourage you to recognize that the season that you are in is important. It can be exciting, it can be joyful, it can be used by the Lord, and you don't want to miss out on that season by thinking about a different one. And I'd like to give you a personal example of that. Before we had children, Baruch and I did almost everything together, and we had so much fun. It was really a great time. And then when we started having children, I was trying to live our lives as I did before we had children. And I really was just knocking my head against a brick wall. I was very frustrated. It was, parts of it were an unhappy time. As I was trying to live my past season in the new season that I was in, and I didn't necessarily enjoy everything as much as I should have. So I want you to really think about the season that you're in and how you can thrive in it and how it can be exciting and joyful, and that you can serve the Lord in whatever season that you're in. Another thing is, I want you to think about God's will and responding to His will, and what are we to accomplish in the end? We are to be an instrument of God, to be used for His plans and purposes. And it's so exciting if we participate with Him and recognize how we can participate with Him in His plans. And another way to participate with Him is to also recognize how we are to serve Him with the spiritual gifts that He's given. In Romans chapter 12, we read about the different spiritual gifts that we have, and we need to use those for Him. We read about the fact that the body of believers is made up of many parts. Not everyone is a head, not everyone is an arm. We each have a role to play so that the body can function healthfully and in a really effective way here on earth. So you are important no matter what your gift is, no matter what part of the body you are. We need to step forward, each of us, and use those gifts for the healthiness of the entire body. Another thing we need to do is live intentionally. Now, what does that exactly mean? As we do things, as we contemplate things, we need to think, is this profitable? Is this something that is putting forth fruit which will benefit the kingdom of God? We want to be pleasing to God. We want to further the kingdom of God, and we want to remember that our time is short. And I mean that in two different ways. First, the time is short, meaning I think that the end is getting closer and closer. And the second thing, when I say that time is short, I mean our personal time. The time goes so quickly, and I think just about every old person, as they're nearing their end, they say, the time went so quickly. I can't believe, you know, it just seems like yesterday I was in college. It seems like yesterday my children were little. And so we need to realize that our time is short. James talks about how our lives are a vapor, and we need to use every minute wisely from an eternal standpoint. And finally, I would just like to encourage you to invest in your family. This is something that's for the kingdom. It's for a praiseworthy life. It says in the Bible that anyone who does not care for his children is worse than a heathen. We are to make our time, our resources, everything available to invest in our families. So I would like to encourage, especially you women who maybe have put a career on hold or kind of gave up on having a career in order to raise your children, that was a worthy decision. And I'm not judging anyone if you're unable to do that. I understand. I'm not saying that. But those who may feel and may have received criticism for staying at home and raising children, it is a worthwhile, it is a blessing task to do. And I want to encourage you, if you are doing that, to enjoy that season as well and not butt your head up against a wall like I did. And finally, I want to teach you all a new Hebrew word, and that's mashpia. Mashpia means an influencer. And that is what we all are. One way or another, for good or for bad, we are an influencer within our families, within our communities, and here within the world. So always recognize people are watching you, people are listening to you, and have a positive testimony here in the world. Be a mashpia for the Lord and for the kingdom. So I hope this gives you a little bit of perspective on how to have a wonderful midlife without a crisis. Until next time, have a great day.